Steve Edwards.
Ladies and gentlemen, Tim Conway.
What a night.
Tim. Oh, thanks for being with us.
He's still my
that
foolish heart.
Okay,
my
coming up
goodness.
Next on STN. Oh, we're not finished yet.
Thank goodness for that fire. Boy, it's chilly in here today.
It sure is, isn't it?
Wow, that really warmed things up. Thank you so much. What a delightful audience.
What
that
an
is.
Audience.
Beautiful.
Well,
what a year.
Excited.
What a night. What a life.
Excited you're here.
They should be, too.
Yeah,
yes.
They are. They are.
And they are.
And we dressed for it.
I don't have a suit coat. That's why I didn't wear it. I actually have no shirt on. It's just a little dickie here. And, as you can see, there are no sleeves. And there's no back to my pants.
Where's Bob? Bob, can you come in for a moment? We were so excited that you were going to be on.
Oh, really?
We called each other at home.
That's nice. You wore the same jacket.
We're wearing our Tom coats.
Boy, that is nice.
You like them? So we dressed alike for you.
Very nice.
We used to go on the air as the Four Aces, but the two of them won't go on
two
with
aces,
us anymore,
it's
right?
Cheap, yes.
Boy.
Thank you.
Very nice, yes.
I said in the introduction before, Tom Conway.
As you know, yes. That Tim Conway is not my real name. Mm-hmm. My real name, of course, is Betty, which we had some problem without her. Okay. All right, so the story's out. All right. Tom Conway, there was a Tom Conway who was George Saunders' brother.
Tom
and
Conway.
If you know,
like the Whistler or whatever in the movies.
The Falcon.
The Falcon, yes.
Or the Falcon's brother or something of that nature. And you can't have two people in the union with the same name. So when I was on the Steve Allen show, notice how I threw out a lot of high-powered names. Mm-hmm. Steve Allen, he changed my name. He was going to call me Tom Kinway, and then he decided to call me Tim Conway. And that's how that name was truly changed. Yeah. Just a little show business inside story, folks.
Now, what are you at home? What does Charlene call you at home?
Hey, or come over here. She calls me Tim. Mm-hmm. Tim.
And old friends, what do they call you?
Very seldom. Okay. I really try to disassociate myself with old friends because I usually try to borrow money, so I don't get any calls at all from old friends. No, I guess most of them call me Tom. My mother, now I'm an only child, and I call my mother, whenever I call her, I say, "Hi, Mom," and she says, "Who is this?" Now, I called on Mother's Day and said, "Hi, Mom," and she said, "Who is this?" And that's the truth. Now, people don't believe that, but there are several witnesses in my home that when I call my mom, she goes, "Who is it?"
Of course, Tim Conway, you mentioned the Steve Allen show, and then you went on to McHale's Navy, and then a string of unsuccessful television shows in your own name.
A long string.
A lot of them.
Not just a string. I got the longest string of unsuccessful television shows.
Let's name a few of those shows that didn't last.
Well, Rango.
Rango! I forgot Rango, yes.
That was a big one. That went 13 weeks. A guy from ABC actually came down. You have strange ways of getting canceled, but this guy actually came down and said, "Stop doing this." And that's the last thing we did. Then I did a series of, I did an airplane show with Joe Hamilton. Mm. I did the Tim Conway show, the Tim Conway show, and the Tim Conway show. There was an hour, then there was an hour, or there was a half hour, and then I think it was a news break or something we went to. And it went from 13 weeks to 6 weeks, and I was also on a show called Turn On, which, as you know, is in the Guinness Book of Records for the shortest show that was ever on television.
It's true. It is true.
It was canceled while it was on the air.
Yes.
And that's the truth.
Yes. Explain how that happened. It is true.
George Slaughter, who did Laugh In, a great show, and this was a little advanced of Laugh In, so people were not ready for this. There was a joke in it about the Pope, which you didn't do at that time. And we had a premiere party out here in California. They showed it in New York. And they, as it was coming across the country, they were canceling it. In Cleveland, they shut it off. It was on for 15 minutes. They got to that joke about the Pope, and boom, they called in the guy who hadn't played the organ in 40 years. He just played over a slide. And so by the time I got to California, it was canceled. So it was a premiere party and a cancellation party, which was an economical move. It was great because you didn't have to call out and get more shrimp or anything. We were all still dunking our shrimp out there when it was canceled. So it was nice. We all so the presents you got for the opening were actually opening and closing
and
presents.
And closing, yeah.
Yeah, very
it was
nice.
A wrap party.
Very nice, yeah.
There was also one, which one? The one I liked the best was the one that had the Tim Conway dancer. Which version was that?
Sally Struthers was the dancer. That was a Tim Conway, there were so many, was it Tim Conway show?
Yeah, that was on CBS.
Yes, and Art Matrona was the band.
Yeah.
We only had one guy in the band, and Sally Struthers was the dancer. It was supposed to be like the Rockettes, and she'd get on the floor and form stars and things like that with her, and she was only one dancer. People thought, gee, that show would go a lot better if you had a band and more dancers. See, they didn't see the humor.
They didn't get the humor.
The humor was
They get it now.
They get it now.
They get it now, but they didn't get it then.
It's 7 years late now. Yeah. Way too late.
Of course, they didn't know who Sally Struthers was then.
They didn't know who I was.
Yeah, well, that was the problem. And then the Christmas show.
I had an hour show, and I didn't, this was the first show we taped, and I said, I think we better tape, because of my history, the Christmas show first.
Because?
Because I didn't think I'd be on by Christmas. And I was off. So the first show was our Christmas show.
In September.
Had all the kids on and sang Christmas carols and everything. And by Christmas, I was canceled. So it worked out very nicely. I got a chance to get the kids on and everything.
And then, of course, the Carol Burnett show. And there are no jokes.
Yeah, that annoyed
me. It worked too well.
Yeah, because that went on 10 years.
Yeah.
It really annoyed me.
That could have
me.
Hurt your career.
It did.
Yes.
Yeah, I tried never to be number one, which, as you know, I've been successful.
Would you explain that philosophy about the numbers?
Well, I don't like to be number one. Yes. I never want to be number one. Mm-hmm. I have tried to keep my picture off People, Us, Life magazine, and all. And as you know, I've been very successful
succeeded.
There.
Yes.
And I've had to have, tried to have a successive failures, which I did.
Yes.
That worked out good. And I like to be in the middle of the ladder rather than the top of the bottom, because you see a lot of people going up and a lot of people coming down. Big pile at the bottom down there. But if you're in the middle, you sustain.
Yeah.
Yeah.
They don't notice you, so they don't
They don't notice
you. Sure.
They step on you on the way up.
So the Burnett show came around, ruined it.
Ten years.
Proved yourself as one of the most brilliant sketch comedians.
Very annoying lady. Yes. Yeah, yes. She went on for 10 years.
Got to work with Harvey, what's his name?
Harvey... Oh, boy.
Kinman.
Harvey Kinman.
Yeah, Harvey Kinman. Harvey Kornman.
Yep. And I still see Harvey with some regularity. He is the kind of guy who sits at home trying to figure out how much money everybody is making. And so he has an adding machine at home, and he's never out of his robe before 4 o'clock in the afternoon. Still just working that machine.
Harvey Kornman.
Or Harvey Kornman.
Yes.
Has Lloyd Bridges confused him. He doesn't know how much Lloyd Bridges made in his entire life, so that's the only one that's confused.
That's always confused.
He has no idea. He doesn't know whether they got paid for that show, owned it, or what.
Now, how did you get involved in thoroughbred racing and your almost addiction that you have to it?
I was exercising horses, galloping horses, as they say in the business, when I was 12 and 14 years old in Cleveland, Ohio, at a track called Randall Park. I wanted to be a jockey. I still do. But at this weight, horses do ask you to get off.